Hello, and welcome to the Limbo of Fantasy. My name is Ola, and today we are on the episode 7 of a mini-series of videos which focuses on analyzing the differences between the TV show and the books. We take every episode under scrutiny, one by one, and see what the show changed, what people and events show presented differently than the books do. So, obviously, there will be spoilers ahead. Today, we are talking about Season 1, Episode 7, Before a Fall. This episode is based mainly on the Something More story. However, it only takes tiny bits and pieces of information from it and invents a lot. This episode is therefore very specific. It has so many show-only scenes that have no counterparts in the books that there seems to be little to talk about besides repeating, "Nope, that never happens in the books." However, there are some things we can compare and analyze. Number 1. Ciri. In this episode, we see Ciri wandering through the busy town and planning to get to Skellige. She meets Golden Cheeks, steals her horse, and is later attacked in the fields by her former friends. All her adventures in this episode are a show-only invention. In the books, Ciri was taken in by the druids, along with many other orphans of war, and is later adopted by Golden Cheeks. Interestingly, when Ciri is attacked in the fields, she gives us a prophecy. Those are the first sentences of the prophecy of Iflina from the books. It is the most known prophecy in the world. In the books, Ciri also gives a lot of prophecies and sees the future many times. However, it happens under different circumstances, and she never repeats the prophecy of Iflina. Although she does see it in her nightmares and experiences it in prophetic visions in the Blood of the Elves book. Ciri's scenes during the slaughter of Cintra we mostly already saw in the episode 1, and here we just get a tiny bit more details, with nothing really new to talk about. Number 2. Geralt and Calanthe. In the show, Geralt comes back to Cintra because he sees armies of Nilfgaard amassing and gets worried about the safety of his Child of Surprise. We are told that this is 12 years after the Cintra party from the episode 4. And right away, this timing is somewhat confusing. If it is indeed 12 years after the party, that would make Ciri at most 12 years old here during the slaughter of Cintra. But in the episode 1, it was suggested that Ciri is 15 years old. Ciri said there that she is as old as Calanthe was when she won her first major battle of Hochebus, and Calanthe was 15 at the time. So, by now, show Ciri's age seems confused. But if she is indeed 12 years old here, that would make her the same age as Book Ciri. But anyway, Geralt arranges a meeting with Mousesack to make sure that the child is safe. However, assassins sent by Calanthe follow the druid and try to kill the Witcher. Geralt finally meets with the lioness and wants to take Ciri to keep her safe from Nilfgaard attack. Calanthe has other plans and wants to fool Geralt, give him a different girl. When her ruse fails, she has the Witcher thrown into prison. None of those events happen in the books, but they are loosely based on events from the Something More story. In the books, Geralt comes back to Cintra when Ciri is 6 years old, just as he promised. His visit has nothing to do with Nilfgaard attack on Cintra. He is not really sure why he came back, and he doesn't want to claim the child. He just wants to look in the face of destiny. We find out from Mousesack that Book Calanthe also planned on having Geralt killed and wanted to send Mousesack himself to do the deed. But the queen changed her mind for some unknowable reason and the assassination attempt never took place. Book Calanthe, same as the show one, does not want to give Ciri away. However, she is not brazen enough to just spit in the face of destiny. She is clearly torn between her love for Ciri her desire to keep her safe, and fear of the power of destiny that may yet take its vengeance on her if she dares to defy it. She decides to set up a game for the Witcher instead. She makes Ciri play with 9 other boys in the city mode, and she tells Geralt that he has one chance to choose a child from among those 10, and whichever child he chooses, he will take with him. Geralt refuses to play the game. He doesn't even want to look at the child anymore. He renounces his destiny, taking the burden off Calante, and rides away. The lioness changes her mind in the meantime and tells the Witcher that his child will be waiting for him, if he ever wants to take her. Shaw Calante has different ideas and tells Aist to imprison the Witcher. That puts Geralt right in the middle of the action during the slaughter of Cintra. He escapes his prison cell and continues searching for Ciri, but never finds her. Book Geralt was never there during the slaughter. He was traveling to Cintra at the time as he wanted to go get Ciri, but he met Jaskier near the ferry crossing on Yaruga River and found out from the bard about the Nilfgaard attack. He found out that the city is burned and its people slaughtered. There was nothing left for him in Cintra, so he turned back and went with Jaskier instead. Number 3. Yennefer and Istred. In the show, Yennefer travels to Nazaïr to meet Istred and presumably rekindle her relationship with him. She is rejected. Istred tried for many years to get close to her, but she was shutting down all of his attempts. He eventually came to his senses, and now he doesn't want her anymore. Good for him. Those scenes, as really all the other in this episode, are show only. In the books, Yennefer has an off and on, non-committal relationship with Istred for quite a long time. She romances him at the same time that she romances Geralt, basically running from one into the arms of the other. Book Istred loves Yennefer and at some point decides that he wants her all to himself. He proposes an exclusive relationship and wants Yen to move in with him, and this is where Yennefer dumps him for good. However, Book Istred does not have as much resilience or self-respect as the show one. Rejected by the woman he loves, he plans to commit suicide by Witcher and challenges Geralt to a sword fight. Geralt does not indulge him. Distressed, Istred screams that he will never give up Yennefer, that he cannot live without her, and this is the last time we see him. Book Istred also, as far as we know, never works in Nazaïr and never goes to Nilfgaard at all. Number 4. Arethusa and politics. As with everything else in this episode, the Arethusa scenes are a show-only addition. Yennefer comes back to the tower at the urging of Vilgefortz, who wants her to join the fight against Nilfgaard. We get more scenes presenting Yennefer's emotional distress, as well as her hate for Arethusa and sorceress organizations as a whole. She complains again how they took away her ability to procreate, even though she was the one that made the conscious decision to give it up. Nobody forced her. She complains about all the lies and schemes of the sorcerers. Book Yennefer is quite different. She is tormented by her infertility, but never blames anyone for taking it away from her. Well, maybe she blames the unfair fate in general. And she never makes a choice to give it up. It's just a consequence of using magic that many, but not all, magicians experience. Book Yennefer also takes part in a lot of the scheming of the mages, and manipulating people is really almost a second nature to her. She also has great respect for Arethusa as a school, and wants Ciri to go to study there. We are also told that Shaw Arethusa has been taking on students from rich, noble families, even those with no magical affinity, just for the sake of getting paid. Nothing like that is ever mentioned in the books. And in the books, you have to pay quite a bit of money to study in Arethusa anyway. As Molnar tells us in The Time of Contempt, it costs 1200 Novigrad crowns per year, and there is an additional matriculation fee of 200 crowns for new novices. Shaw Yennefer seems extremely surprised that Glacella's parents paid for her studies in Arethusa, so it seems that in the show, magical education, student housing, and all the other related things are usually provided for free. In the show, we see an emergency gathering of mages discussing Nilfgaardian forces, with two factions disagreeing on how to proceed. We never see such events or quarrels in the books. The general political situation is the same in the books, however. There, Nilfgaardian forces were conquering more and more lands, leaving scorched earth behind them. They defeated Cintrian forces at Marnadal and took the city by storm. Only the keep itself resisted for 4 days before falling. There is a moment in the show when Fringilla states that Nilfgaard is only interested in Cintra, which would be different from the situation in the books. However, she may just be lying. It is also worth mentioning that in the books, Fringilla is not a court sorceress in Nilfgaard. She is a Nilfgaardian sorceress, but she is never an advisor to the Emperor. Actually, Nilfgaard keeps their mages at a distance from the court. The only known exception to this rule was Xarthisius, who was exactly a court mage and astrologist of M. Hrvar Emrys. So, it seems that Shaw Fringilla is taking over his role. We also get an interesting bit of information about forbidden magics in the show: demonology, necromancy, and fire magic. In the books, the chapter forbids necromancy and goetia. Goetia is a practice of summoning demons, but fire magic is not something that is forbidden. Coral, also known as Litanate, even says that pyromancy is very useful when foretelling people's fates. The energy of fire is very dangerous to draw on, and you have to be experienced and powerful to make use of it. Otherwise, you can get completely overwhelmed, or maybe even go insane. But you don't need to draw your energy from fire to cast a fire spell. You can draw on any elemental source you have available. That's how it is in the books. But, as we established many times before, show magic works different than book magic. Thank you very much for listening. If you enjoyed this video, subscribe to get notified of the continuance of this series. Leave a like and consider sharing the video with others. It really helps the channel. I hope to always be improving, so suggestions, comments, and constructive criticism are welcome. Leave them in the comments below. Have a nice day, and I'll see you next time.